Good morning and welcome. My name's Dan Hancock, and I'm the chairman of the Little Hoover Commission. And before we begin, I'd like to introduce our fellow commissioners who are with us here today. To my right are Commissioner Cacho and Assemblymember Cacho Asajjan, Senator Mark Weiland, our new commissioner, Commissioner Mark Vargas, Commissioner David Schwarz, and to my immediate right, Commissioner Marilyn Brewer. To my far left, new commissioner Tom Quinn at his first meeting as well today. Commissioner Lauren Kay, and joining us shortly, his plane's delayed, from Los Angeles, Commissioner Jonathan Shapiro. Also with us this morning are Executive Director Stuart Drown and our Deputy Director Carol D'Elia, our Research Analyst Beth Curta, and our Staff Services Analyst Sherry McAllister are in the front row. This is the third hearing the Commission is holding to review the state's coordination of energy-related activities. The study will include an evaluation of entities that share authority over energy policy, permitting, and regulation. The Commission will assess how the state's energy-related organizations are working together, hopefully, to achieve state goals and facilitate efforts to improve the generation and delivery of power to consumers. At today's hearing, the Commission will hear from Tanya Bodell, Managing Director and Co-Founder of the Electricity Consulting Group of FTI Consulting. We will then hear from Carl Zakella, Director of Western Transmission for the National Resources Defense Council, about transmission issues in energy production in the West. Following his testimony, Bob Foster, Mayor of Long Beach and Chair of the California Independent System Operator, will discuss the state's energy goals and California's path to those goals. Following Mayor Foster's testimony, we will hear from Jan Smutney-Jones, Executive Director of the Independent Energy Producers Association, on improving transparency in energy costs. And finally, Matt Friedman, a staff attorney for the Utility Reform Network, and Joe Como, Acting Director of the Division of Ratepayer Advocates, will discuss the state's energy goals and what achieving them will cost. There will be an opportunity for public comment following the testimony of the scheduled witnesses. Please notify our commission staff here in the front row. If you would like to provide comment, we will take it at the end of the public hearing. We'd ask you to fill out a card and we'll recognize you at that time. Today's hearing will be achieved or archived on the California Channel's website. Immediately following the public hearing, the commission will hold its business meeting across the street in the Ledge Council's conference room in the lower level at 925 L Street. I would like to thank the witnesses in advance for their testimony. In most cases, we've had an opportunity to review that, and some we haven't, but I would ask you, even so, to summarize your testimony and the major points that you would like to make so that we can focus our time on discussion. And with that, I would ask the Executive Director to call our first witness this morning.
To provide an analysis of cost comparisons for renewable power in California, Tanya Bodell. Ms. Bodell is the Managing Director and Co-Founder of the Electricity Consulting Group within FTI Consulting, a global business advisory firm. Ms. Bodell has nearly 20 years of experience providing business advisory and expert support to electric power sector clients. Her previous experience includes leadership positions at Charles River Associates in Boston and Putnam, Hayes, and Bartlett in Washington, D.C. Good morning, Ms. Bodell.
Welcome. Thank you for coming. And please proceed.
Thank you. So I have submitted two documents.
Oh, I am. Good. I've submitted two documents. I apologize you did not have the advance submission. One is comments, written comments with exhibits, a more formal expert testimony type of report. The other is a PowerPoint slide presentation which hits the highlights, and in the meeting the objective of being focused, I'd like to have us turn to the PowerPoint slide presentation, if that's all right. And that is the document that looks like this, and there are some extra copies for the audience.
We'll post this on our website.
I have been asked to come to look at the costs of alternative renewable resources for purposes of meeting the California Renewable Portfolio Standard. And I think there's some good information in here which will help you get your arms around the numbers, but we've put graphs together to really make it more visual. In general, my executive summary is as follows. There are superior renewable resources that exist outside of California. Not only do they have higher capacity factors, but they also have more options for purposes of siting. And in addition to that, there are lower construction costs outside of California. Combined, those renewable resources that are out of state are more cost effective. And even though they are further away from California, and in some cases require transmission upgrades and even new transmission builds, taking that into account, they're still more cost competitive than some of the in-state resources. So it's a very powerful economic aspect, and I would ask the Commission to really consider the purpose of the, or the ability of the external resources to be able to meet the needs more cost effectively. And we walk through what some of those costs are, the cost comparisons, and what limiting the imports of renewables from other states implies for the ratepayers of California. The RPS legislation limits, as you probably know by now, do limit the imports that can come into California. There is a recent ruling as of December 15, 2011, where the administrative law judge attempted to clarify some of the definitions that are in the legislation. And my report talks through a high-level summary of what some of those decisions were. Even with those clarifications, however, it is apparent that it is more difficult for imports of renewables to come into California for purposes of meeting the renewable portfolio standard. As a result, it is possible that the majority of the renewable portfolio standard will be met with in-state resources. This has the benefit of property taxes or payments in lieu of taxes, if that's assessed. It also has the benefits of job creation. However, it is a very costly investment to significantly limit the imports of renewables. Limiting the imports of renewables has two impacts. One is the additional cost, which we'll talk about, but the other is the limitations on the flexibility for purposes of the utilities to be able to meet their portfolio. In general, with these types of procurements, the more flexible, the more competitive, the more dynamic the opportunities are to procure renewables, the more cost-effective, the more diverse, and the more optimal the portfolio will be. I will walk through the analysis that shows limiting the imports of renewables can cost hundreds of millions of dollars a year and billions of dollars over the life of the RPS program. The first thing I'd like to talk through, starting on page 4, are some very beautiful color charts that are created by the National Renewable Energy Laboratory. Having been in the industry for 20 years, it is amazing how often these charts are the starting point for discussion about renewables. And so I've followed that trend, and I've included 4 charts. The first, on page 4, is the wind potential by state. Now what you see is California generally is green, which means that there are lower wind speeds. Purple is the best type of wind. Some of that is not accessible because it's on the top of mountains. But the chart that's in the bottom left-hand corner indicates, again from the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, indicates what the available land space is for the 11 states in the Western Electricity Coordinating Council, or the WECC, interconnect. Something important to consider, if you look at that big purple slash through the middle, those are the Rocky Mountains. The electricity system in the United States has 3 interconnects. And generally, the power that serves California is going to be west of the Rocky Mountains. But that said, there's still very superior renewable resources in the form of wind in New Mexico, Wyoming, Montana, and Colorado. And again, the larger available land that allows for a 30% capacity factor or above at an 80-meter height above the ground is a more cost-effective solution for wind renewables. So a substantial amount of wind resources exist outside of California. The next map I'd like you to look at is page 5. This starts to address the solar resources that are available in the United States. As you can see, California has very good solar resources. Arizona has better, and in parts of New Mexico also have better. And in the economics of the renewable resources, which we will talk about later in my discussion, it's very important how much electricity is going to be produced, because the bulk of the cost associated with building a solar facility or wind facility are upfront costs. The marginal cost of production is negligible because the wind is free and the sun shines, and we love that. But because of that, you have to levelize the cost, and the more higher your capacity factor, the cheaper the cost in a dollar per megawatt hour basis it is. But photovoltaic opportunities are plentiful in Southern California and the surrounding states. Page 6 talks about concentrating solar potential. Now, the difference between the photovoltaics and the concentrating thermal is a technology issue. Right now, the photovoltaics, in part because of the investment China has made and the big investment in Europe, has had huge cost decreases over time. And the concentrating solar has not yet caught up, so it's now a more expensive option. But the concentrating solar basically takes the sun, heats water, and with that heating and the steam production is able to produce electricity. And what this page 6 shows is that a lot of the solar power prospects for concentrating solar are in the southwestern United States. And because it's thermal, it's important that the air temperature is hot, because if it's colder air temperature, it has a reduction in efficiency. And so, therefore, concentrating solar is not very useful in northern parts of the United States. These green lines on this map show the existing transmission infrastructure. So you can see that there is the ability to transfer energy produced by these external resources into California. And then the last pretty map I'd like to show you is a geothermal. When I do my calculations, I do not address geothermal. I focus on wind and solar cost comparisons. But as you can see on page 7, there's a significant amount of geothermal resources along the Ring of Fire, and in particular along the Nevada-California border. So in conclusion of this section, there are significant renewable resources that exist outside of California, but California also has some very significant renewable resources as well. So my testimony is not going to say you should not use California resources. My testimony is that we should keep options open for the most cost-effective, diversifiable resources. And as you'll see when I talk about the relative costs, there are times and assumptions under which the California resources are more cost-effective than other states. Now I'm going to move on to the RPS requirements in California. And I will touch on this very briefly just to make sure that we're all on the same page. And I apologize, I've looked at the prior testimony, so I'm sure you're very informed. But as you know, there are three buckets for renewable resources under SB 2 1X. And the requirement for renewables is that California electric utilities, load-serving entities, must increase the portion of their retail sales from approved renewable resources according to the following timeline: 20% of the total gigawatt hours produced must come from the RPS eligible or the approved renewable resources by 2013, next year, 25% of retail sales by 2016, and 33% of retail sales by 2020. And California, ever the aspirational, Governor Brown, as you know, has expressed aspirations for perhaps a 40% renewable portfolio standard. The buckets that are described by SB 2-1X try to address the delivery issue. So just because renewable power is produced outside of the state doesn't mean that it flows into California. In fact, physically, it will flow wherever Kirchhoff's laws say that it should flow. But what the California legislature wanted to do was try to show that, except for the 10% bucket number 3, where you may remove the renewable energy credit from the actual energy and use that energy credit for purposes of meeting your requirement, in general, for bucket 1 and number 2, they have to be the same. Now, quick discussion about the renewable energy credit. I was involved with that discussion back in 1998 when different markets, including Ontario, New England, PJM, California, were looking to track green power. And in designing the competitive markets, it was important to make sure that there was a verifiable way of showing that the renewable power had been purchased and even delivered. But because the actual electrons go wherever they want to go, what economists decided to do was separate the property right of claiming that it was renewable from the actual energy. So creating effectively a gray electron that's not considered green unless there's a separate certificate associated with it. Now, the certificate serves to provide an increased revenue stream to renewables, which helps them to be economically viable. And so in some markets, in order to be able to meet your renewable portfolio standard, all you have to do, such as New England, all you have to do is buy the appropriate amount of renewable energy credits. You don't have to show that they were transmitted to a certain location or into the utility service territory. And that serves the purpose of providing a revenue stream to the renewable energy producers. Now, in other states, they have also carved out specific type of renewable energy credits. There are now SRECs for the solar renewable energy credits and ORECs for the offshore renewable energy credits. And this is happening on the East Coast. So renewable energy credits are a very popular way of verifying that the utility has provided the appropriate revenue flow to the renewable resources through the form of a separately traded certificate. Now, in the California legislation, that is only limited to 10% of the renewable resource requirements, and that's bucket three. And that's bundled RECs that do not deliver energy into California. But buckets one and two attempt to show that the delivery actually occurred. And again, the physical electron does not flow into California. It's more trying to show that a financial or a scheduling of power from out of state into California occurred. Now, that creates some contortions. And in fact, the language in the legislation has some of those contortions. On first reading, it looks very apparent. You know, bucket two, for example, is going to be a firmed and shaped resource providing incremental electricity into a California balancing authority. But when the administrative law judge reviewed that, just in that sentence alone, the administrative law judge focused on what does firm mean, what does shaped resource mean, what does incremental electricity mean, and what does California balancing authority mean. I think the only words he did not focus on were and providing into a. Number one, bucket number one, is a bit more complicated. Initially when this came out, the industry was very concerned that bucket number one was going to be exclusively California-based renewables. And that would mean that 75% of the renewable portfolio standard would have to be met with in-state renewables. There was a lot of discussion back and forth about whether external resources could meet the bucket one criteria. There was a lot of focus 6 months ago on requirement number C, which is that energy delivered to a California balancing authority under a dynamic transfer occurs. But there's a lot of debate and discussion about what a dynamic transfer is. And unfortunately, it's still not clear, because a dynamic transfer is an agreement between two balancing authorities. And by the way, when the clarification on point number A in bucket one occurred, it was determined that there are five balancing authorities within California that meet the requirement that more than 50% of their load are within the California boundaries. But with respect to the dynamic transfer, that's an agreement between balancing authorities. The balancing authorities are the grid operators who make sure that the lights stay on and that the electrons flow appropriately. And the agreement between them about dynamically transferring actual power flows is more of a reliability issue. And what bucket number one does in the legislation is it tries to make the dynamic transfer agreement a means of determining whether or not an equivalent amount of power from renewable resources out of state actually flowed into California. Now, when this language first came out, nobody quite knew what it meant. And when the administrative law judge looked at it in his ruling on December 15th, basically concluded, this is about an agreement between two balancing authorities. This is not about the renewable resource producer entering into an agreement with the balancing authority. And it's not about the renewable energy producer entering into an agreement with the utility. This is about an agreement between the balancing authorities. So it's sort of up to them whatever they decide is an appropriate dynamic transfer that's going to carry the day. Unfortunately, it was a bit of a punt. And there's still not a lot of clarity on what is required for purposes of a dynamic transfer to allow external resources to import into California.
So would that possibly lead you to the conclusion that bucket one does not all have to be internally produced in California?
Well, and in fact, that's a great question because number B, the administrative law judge says that implies that in fact imports can come into California under bucket one. So I think there
that
was...
That would not be consistent with most of what we've heard over the last 6 months. So that's interesting.
It was, and in preparing for this testimony, I reviewed the administrative law judge's ruling, and it was very insightful, very interesting, actually a pretty good read, knowing the history behind how the speculation was on these, how this legislation was going to be interpreted. And what the administrative law judge concluded was, when you talk about energy scheduled into a California balancing authority, and it's that word into, which actually he did give a definition to for Part B, when you schedule it into a California balancing authority, that implies an import. Now, regardless of what it implies, it is still much more difficult and still vague as to whether or not Bucket 1 is going to be able to have RPS-eligible resources from out of state. So I think further clarification is required. Some of it will be operational, but it is very possible that that 75% bucket will be exclusively in-state.
Who provides that clarification?
The California Energy Commission was where the ruling came out of, and that is cited in my expert testimony that I had provided.
Okay.
But it is very possible that Bucket 1 will not include imports, especially if the concept of dynamic transfer is not clarified, or if it's clarified in a way that prevents the renewable resource providers from having any control over it. And it's also possible, frankly, that number two, bucket number two, which everybody conceivably thought was focused on imports, would actually be successful in allowing imports to come in because it requires the firming and the shaping, and the renewable resource provider would have to obtain that. And incremental electricity means that it has to be in addition to what the balancing authority is already bringing in. And again, I think although there was further clarification from the administrative law judge that pushed the ball forward as of December 15th, 2011, there still are outstanding questions as to how much imported renewable resources may be used to meet the renewable portfolio standards.
Did anybody ask Senator Simitian what his intent was?
I'm sorry?
Did anybody ask Senator Simitian what his intent was?
I don't know.
Okay.
I think the industry felt, or members in the industry felt, that there were two intentions. One was to try to keep the dollars in California, the jobs, the property taxes, the building, the construction, and that by limiting the imports with such language, that would allow that. But I think there was also potentially a concern that we'd be violating cross-border transactions if there was an outright prohibition on imports coming in. And that may explain why some of the language is purposely vague. And again, the administrative law judge's conclusions, including on bucket one, imply that imports can come in and meet those buckets so that there's not a violation of cross-border trade requirements. But again, the actual operational implementation still needs to be worked out.
Senator Weiland, did you want to ask?
Yeah, I'd just be curious what Senator Simidian's thoughts would be and the administration's thoughts. My own sense of it when we did this was that the number one goal was the RPS port, the renewable energy, and that having the domestic production was really secondary and kind of an add-on. But I'd be curious what...
I think we just chatted. I think we're going to call a senator and ask you.
Yeah, and I think it'd be good at some point to find out from the administration when they signed it, and in terms of the governor's commitment. Well, actually, was that signed under... I'm not sure if that was signed under Schwarzenegger or was that Brown? Yeah. Well, then, because Simidian has done, there have been multiple of those. I think it'd also be really good to get his take, because that's the guy who's going to be trying to push this forward.
Okay. Keep going.
Sure.
We do this a lot.
No, this is great. Keep it interesting. I think they're also... was somewhat of a legacy holdover from the prior legislation, which had some very clear delivery requirements. Now, interestingly, I don't know if there was an attempt to try to relax this, but the ruling indicated that, in fact, bucket number two makes it stricter on how you prove that you had the delivery and what the delivered power must look like. So there's, for 12 years, no, 14 years now, since I was working on those renewable energy credits in 1998, there was a lot of concern by people who think in terms of delivery. If I buy an apple, I want to see the apple. If I buy a green electron, I want to see the green electron. I want to come in. And just the way the power flows makes that very difficult. And the way that the financial contracts circulate make it very difficult to track the dollars. And so that's where ultimately, as economists, we came to the conclusion that the cleanest, easiest way to do this is by separating the property right associated with the type of energy, such as a renewable energy credit, from the actual electron. And they can be purchased in a bundled way, or they can be separated. And so on the East Coast, most of the markets separate them, and it's just simply a question of whether the utility holds a renewable energy credit.
Yes, Mr. Burke.
I'm just curious, you're stating, I think, in your data here that the costs for development out of state are probably a lot lower than in state. Do the costs incorporate distribution and transmission to bring it over state lines as well?
Right. So on the statement related to the construction, that comes from the NREL information, which is a DOE department. And the construction costs are just the construction costs. What I'll show later on is taking into account the existing tariff structure and the miles that have to be over which the power has to be transmitted, the cost efficiencies associated with the lower cost of construction and the higher capacity factor and the ability to access more land options for more optimal resources. Those cost savings offset the higher cost of transmission in some cases. So the statement that you reference is solely focused on regional construction costs.
And when you say they offset, does it come out as almost a net equal, or is it still substantially?
Stay tuned. I'm about to get to that point. So on page 10, I think we summarized what some of the existing outstanding items are with respect to implementing the renewable portfolio standard requirements. All right, now we're going to get into an equation, page 11, and don't let this scare you. In order to come to a calculation, and of course these are all estimates, and you'll see why every step of the way. Page 11, sorry. In order to, let's take a step back before I focus on the math. if you want to understand how much incrementally a limitation on imported renewable resources would cost ratepayers, you need to know two things. What's the incremental cost of the in-state resources, and what's the, and that's the price, and what's the quantity that needs to be procured under the existing renewable portfolio standard? Because California has a long history of supporting renewable resources, and there's been a lot of procurement that's already been done. And so what I'm about to talk about right now is what's the unmet need. How, and this might be informational for your other purposes, but how far along are the utilities in procuring what needs to be procured to meet the RPS requirements? So how do you come up with that? Well, the market size, or the unmet need, is equal to the projected load of each of the utilities times the percentage renewable resource requirement times an adjustment for the bucket, bucket one, bucket two, bucket three. But you have to subtract off from that the existing supply that's already been procured. And you also have to subtract off from that some of the approved projects or the approved PPAs that have already been procured, even though those generating units have not yet been built. Now here's where some uncertainty comes into play. What's the load going to be? Well, the ISO creates projections, utilities produce projections, and so we took those projections. What's our RPS goal? That's fairly straightforward and laid out, escalating up to 33% by 2020. What's the eligibility adjuster? That's where we get to the bucket one, bucket two requirements. What's the existing supply that's publicly available? So we were able to grab that for each of the load-serving entities. What are the approved projects? That's also publicly available. But what's the probability that those approved projects will actually become projects? Shockingly, even with a power purchase agreement, which is necessary to get financing, that does not guarantee that the project will proceed. And on average, possibly 50% of the projects with approved PPAs actually go forward and get built. There are siting issues, there are cost overruns, there are other issues that result in delay and potentially projects not being built. So what we've done there is we've assumed a 50% success rate, and then to be optimistic, we've also assumed a 90% success rate. And so if you look at the bucket one and bucket one and two calculations, you see what we've assumed for each of those variables. Doing that calculation, moving to slide 12.
This assumes that we're not counting toward the 33% state RSP goal existing renewable energy sources.
No, this does.
But for purposes of counting, whether or not we are in compliance with the 33% target, existing renewable sources in the state up and running aren't to be counted toward meeting that goal. At least that's the testimony.
I think some are and some aren't.
So have you divided out what is and what isn't?
We have looked at the existing resources and whether or not they would be eligible under the current legislation as we've interpreted.
Right. Okay.
To the best of our ability.
Right, but we could find ourselves in a situation where, practically speaking, we add a substantial amount of renewable energy on top of already existing renewable energy sources. We could potentially get a 40% fallen.
Yes. Yes. And when we get to the incremental cost, I'll indicate what that implication could be. So, in looking at the unmet need for bucket one, let's start with the chart for Northern California to the left. The red line is a total RPS requirement, taking the 33% in 2020 times the projected load. So what you see is there's an upward slope of that red line for two reasons. Load is increasing, and the renewable portfolio requirement is also increasing. The blue line represents the requirement for, in this case, bucket one, which is basically 75% of the red line. So it follows a similar pattern. And then the blue dotted blue line, current RPS resources, low case, that's the projected renewable resources that will be achieved as of each year, including the relevant existing resources plus the approved PPAs multiplied times a probability of a 90% success rate. And the green line, the current RPS resources.
So that would be high case then.
Well, so the you wouldn't believe how much time we spent going back and forth between do we call it low demand, high success,
just
low case, high case.
In the previous page, it says low case equals 50%, high case equals 90%. I assume that means 90% probability of it being successfully operated. No, here we go. At the bottom of the page 12, it says the same.
So
low demand equals, low demand.
The low demand is a high success rate.
Jesus.
I apologize. No, trust me, we went through this.
So low case on here should actually say low demand as opposed to low case?
Correct. No, sorry. Yes, low case, it should say low demand and high demand. Apologies for the confusion.
Still managed to confuse us.
No, I know. So it's there's a the higher the success of the approved power purchase agreements, the lower the unmet need and the lower the demand. So I think what needs to be adjusted, and I can make this adjustment and resend it to you, is in the charts, the low case actually reflects the low demand. And the high case reflects the high demand. And this is for bucket one, so yes, I apologize. Like I said, this is the dynamic nature of the way that the demand and the probability all works out makes it confusing, so you have to follow it. So what does this mean for bucket number one? What this implies is for the 75%, given existing renewable resources and a high probability of seeing the approved power purchase agreements come into place by 2020, there's really not much unmet need. Now this is just for bucket one. It changes when we get to buckets one and two together. And with respect to the high demand case, what that shows, and remember that's when the probability of success of the power purchase agreements actually come into fruition is 50%, which is I think closer to reality. That implies that there's an unmet need in 2020 of around 5,000 gigawatt hours for bucket one. And that's in the chart over to the right. And that's for Northern California. So remember, we did Northern and Southern California because there's additional transmission costs to go to each of those markets. And we focused on the utilities in Northern California and what their projected load is, what their existing resources are, what their approved power purchase agreements are, multiplied times the success rate to understand where the Northern California utilities are with respect to meeting their portfolio standard. With respect to bucket one, I think they're further along than Southern California utilities are.
Does this factor in the elimination of plants once-through-cooling?
So because this is a renewable portfolio standard, the once-through-cooling plants do not come into play in these calculations. Exactly.
Even though you're starting with projected.
Well, and the load is what's demanded by the consumers. How that load is met is going to be with the combination of resources, which includes the renewable portfolio standard resources.
So just to be clear, looking at the right-hand calculation where you say there's an unmet need, roughly 5,000 gigawatt
only renewables for purposes of meeting the renewable portfolio standard. Yes, the outside of my testimony with respect to the RPS requirement, right, there's a whole separate discussion about reserve margins. Does California have enough power? Is California going to have enough capacity if they retire the ones through cooling units, et cetera?
So the basic teaching of this chart is that it all depends on whether or not we have a high success rate, success in terms of not only the approval of PPAs, but the carrying them to fruition, siting, permitting, constructing, up and running, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So maybe I'm getting a little ahead of the game, but is the delta between the blue dotted line and the red line supposed to be met by resources that are not in bucket one?
So the difference between the blue dotted line and the red line can be met by whatever generating resources the utility chooses. It can be met by nuclear, coal, gas.
I thought the red line was an RPS requirement.
The blue line is the RPS requirement. Oh, I'm sorry. The red line is the total RPS requirement, and then you have the total requirement for bucket one. So, yes. I'm sorry, you are correct. The difference between the blue dotted line and the red line can be met with any other resources outside of bucket one. And you are jumping ahead because on the next page... No, that's good. It's perfect lead-in. Because on the next page, we combine the bucket one and bucket two requirements. And what you see here is that there's a greater unmet need, because when you add the bucket two, there's that much more renewable requirements that are needed to be filled. And effectively, the difference between the red line and the blue line in this case is the bucket three resources, those that can be met by simply acquiring the renewable energy credits. Now, what this projection shows is, in fact, the utilities in Southern California and Northern California have done a fairly good job of procuring renewable resources, and depending on the probability of success of the approved power purchase agreements, there may not be a need to procure additional resources until 2015. Of course, the procurement has to start in advance. But for the most part, what we see with respect to the Southern California chart on the bottom left is that the renewable requirement is met, assuming a high probability of success on the approved power purchase agreements through 2015. Now, if it's hard for those power purchase agreements to turn into actual projects, right, then what you see is that's not met until 2000, until it's just, you're going to have to acquire more renewable resources sooner. So again, it's important, David, as you said, to make sure that the governance is in place to allow for siting and for implementation so that the probability of the power purchase agreements that have been approved actually reaching fruition has a high probability of success. So those numbers over on the charts to the right provide some indication of what the unmet need is for buckets 1 and 2, where you would need to look at the potential incremental cost of imports. And what you see is combined for California, there's approximately 18,000 to 27,000 gigawatt hours of unmet need for buckets 1 and 2 in 2020. Now, this makes sense. There's still time to procure that, but that's, in a sense, unmet need. And the question is, does that come from imports or does it come from in-state resources? So having the cue about what the unmet need is that can be met with either imports or in-state resources, we move on to the next section, which is about the cost. So on page 15, This shows a typical Department of Energy levelized cost of new electricity generation technologies in 2016. So every year the Department of Energy projects what the costs are going to be on a levelized basis, levelized in order to put it on a like-for-like comparison of dollars per megawatt hour. So we're now on page 15. This is sorted by the levelized capital costs on a dollar per megawatt hour, so it shows, relatively speaking, that the renewable resources are more expensive to build. But if you look at the green bar, that's the variable cost of production, you pay more up front, but you pay less out back to produce from solar and from wind. And these are relatively recent, so I don't think they fully incorporate the recent decrease in gas prices. If you incorporated the decrease in gas prices, you might have a little bit of a decrease on the fossil fuel gas combined cycles. But as this is looking at 2016, I think there's a possibility that gas prices may recover by that point.
You're talking natural gas.
Natural gas.
And which one of those combined cycle plants would be the typical California gas turbine, relatively, you know, clean plant?
So the first two would be, I think, the typical California gas turbine. A conventional combined cycle would be a baseload plant. That would be a natural gas plant that you'd expect would operate, well, they're not operating round the clock anymore, but when they were built 10 years ago, everybody thought they'd be operating at 90% capacity factors. In fact, market conditions have changed. But that conventional combined cycle is very efficient, has a heat rate of around 7,000. And so if gas prices are at $3, it's around $21 per megawatt hour to produce electricity from that combined cycle. Very efficient, lower emissions, a very good generating option. The advanced combined cycle has some efficiency improvements. I think that basically is projecting some efficiency improvements by 2016, but those aren't necessarily available yet. And then the combustion turbine are the peaker plants, the natural gas peaker plants. They have a heat rate more like 10,000. And so it's less costly to build in most cases, although in this case, because of the way the capital costs are set up, it's more. But most certainly it's more expensive to operate because it's less efficient. And then the DOE includes in here some advanced combined cycles with CCS, conventional combustion turbines. Those are the peaker plants. The biomass, the interesting thing about biomass is the cost of the biomass tends not to be the biomass so much as the diesel fuel required to get the biomass to the plant. The conventional coal has been increasing in cost, hydroelectric, and it moves on up. But as you all probably know, the renewable resources tend to be more expensive than the fossil fuel plants. And in part, that's because the cost of emissions and other environmental costs associated with the fossil fuel plants are not, from an economic point of view, not necessarily taken into account.
Sparks, thank you. Could I ask a question on variable costs? How are those calculated? Is that just for a one-year period?
So those are on a dollar per megawatt hour basis.
Right.
So it's for every megawatt hour produced. So, for example, if a combined cycle has a 7,000 heat rate and you have $3 gas, then it would cost you 3 times 7,000 divided by 1,000, or $21 per megawatt hour in fuel. In addition to that, you have O&M costs, and there are other costs associated with coal, such as ash removal, that also come into the variable cost equation. But generally, that green is going to be the fuel cost and the O&M costs.
Okay.
But as we've already mentioned, these resources that are out of state have to be transmitted into California, unless they're being purchased under Bucket 3, the RECs. And so on page 16, what we've laid out is some high-level transmission paths that some of the superior resources would take to get into California. So the blue are the wind resources into the Northern and California markets, and then the yellow are the solar resources that are predominantly in the Southwest that would ship through Arizona into Southern California. And we take those into account when calculating the cost of transmission to try to look at the delivered cost of renewables from the imports versus the in-state. Page 7, I apologize again because we have another equation. This is generally how we calculate the delivered cost of renewables. We look at the levelized cost to build the renewable resource. And remember, because it's levelized on a dollar per megawatt hour, the higher the capacity factor, the lower the cost. We do not assume federal grants or tax credits in this analysis because, as you know, they haven't been renewed. And in the post-2016 period, the solar credits expire on the ITC. And then we add in the delivery cost, the transmission. So generally, that long-run marginal cost of production for a new renewable resource is your production cost, how much it costs to produce the energy levelized on a dollar per megawatt hour basis, given the capital costs, plus the transmission costs to ship into California. And whether it ships into Northern California or Southern California drives the transmission costs. So we look at each of those markets separately. So on page 18, what we've done is we've calculated the comparative renewable costs of renewable resources from states outside of California versus the comparative renewable costs for resources within California, assuming the existing transmission tariffs. So there's an infrastructure in place to allow power to be shipped into California. There are some constraints on that, but for purposes of looking at the comparative renewable costs, we kept the existing tariffs as they are. So we went to each of those transmission paths and each of those utilities, and we basically pancaked what the transmission cost would be to get from the high wind resources in Montana over into the Pacific Northwest into Northern California. And that's the transmission cost, the delivery cost. And we did the same thing for New Mexico. Through New Mexico, the utilities, and there's a published wholesale transmission tariff, and we took that, and then we added onto that the transmission tariff for the Arizona utilities into Southern California. And so what's represented on each of these charts is the incremental cost of renewables to Northern California and to Southern California markets delivered, taking into account the lower construction costs and the higher capacity factors, which result in a lower dollar per megawatt hour of production, plus the higher transmission costs because it has to be transmitted further distances to come into California. And this was exactly the question, Commissioner Vargas, you had asked, which is, how do they compare? Do they offset? And in the case of Montana wind, Wyoming wind, and New Mexico wind, for example, versus Northern California wind, in Northern California, they're much more cost effective because they're superior wind resources, so that the lower cost on a dollar per megawatt hour basis of production is not completely offset by the higher transmission cost.
So
Mr. Kay, then Commissioner Schwartz.
So we're not seeing, excuse me, we're obviously not seeing the two terms broken out here. This is just to orient myself. Mm-hmm. This column is called levelized cost. That is the two terms together. In other words, or am I conflating something?
No, those are the two terms together.
Okay. You're correct. And so, obviously, NoCal wind is only the first term. It doesn't include any transmission, right?
That's correct.
And so how would I know of these other competing resources? How much is transmission and how much is production?
I would have to break that out for you, which I'd be happy to do. Yes.
Thank you.
David?
Yeah. So the punchline really is on page 19, right? Which is that under a 33% RPS requirement, we're looking at $100 to $300 million per year in costs that are incurred purely by virtue of these being resources generated in-state as opposed to cheaper, equally accessible out-of-state resource, right?
Correct.
Okay, so with that in mind, one of the witnesses who will appear today, Matt Freeman, writes in his written testimony, quote, although some out-of-state renewable resources offer superior pricing, many cannot provide energy that is useful to California consumers because of transmission limitations. And he cites as an example wind projects located in Alberta, which are RPS eligible. They can offer low prices but cannot physically deliver their energy to California consumers at a reasonable cost. As a result, he goes on to say, procurement from these resources either involves the transfer of electronic RECs that offer no tangible value to California consumers or forces utilities to procure energy in Alberta that must be resold within the region, within that region at a potential loss. Can you comment on that? Because it does seem somewhat in tension with your suggestion, unless Alberta is a, an exception to the otherwise reasonably accessible sources of out-of-state renewables.
So there's a third solution, which he doesn't mention, and that is not estimated here, but we've also done those calculations, and that is to build new transmission to get the resources from the superior locations into California if there's an actual delivery requirement. You know, I think in general, the existing transmission system was built to serve the existing load pockets and to connect the fossil fuel plants. And the load pockets, people don't like to live where it's very, very windy and very, very, very hot. And so as a result, transmission, well, some people might.
Tell that to the Phoenix people.
Right. So as a result, a lot of the superior resources may require additional transmission investment, either upgrades to the existing system or actual new lines to be built.
Okay.
And there are announced projects to do that.
But even factoring in the additional cost of transmission, you still come up with a net benefit to the state of California by using the out-of-state resources.
That is correct.
Okay. And what do you make of the comment about the RECs, there's a transfer of the electronic RECs that offer no tangible value to the consumers in California? Why is that just dollar and cents purposes of figuring out what the ratepayers are going to pay?
Mm-hmm.
Why is that relevant? Help me understand why he's what your view is on RECs as whether or not they deliver tangible value to consumers. Is it just revenue that they generate?
So the RECs generate revenue for the developer and the investor in the renewable project. And that revenue is paid for by the ratepayers who are required to purchase, or whose utility is required to purchase a certain amount of renewable resources. I think it all comes down to what's the objective of a stated policy. If the objective of a renewable portfolio standard is to increase the amount of renewables that are built, and in order to do that, you need to provide a premium to the renewable resource generators. Whether you provide that premium through the purchase of energy and the renewable credit, or whether you just provide it through the renewable energy credit, from the perspective of the developer, financially they should be indifferent.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's a lot easier to take a power purchase agreement to the bank because you have less risk on both the energy and the premium piece to get financing. So I think I don't fully understand what his concern is about the renewable energy credit. As I've said, you know, starting 12 years ago, 14 years ago, when the green power was seen as an option for consumers and environmental policy was being put into place, the renewable energy credits was seen as a very elegant solution to the problem of trying to track delivery of the electrons. And financially, it provides that premium to renewable developers. It's the way the Eastern markets are set up, New England, PJM. It's also the way that Texas is set up. And California is somewhat of an exception in focusing so much on actual delivery into the California border.
Yeah, that anticipates my next question. Is there any other state in the union
that has something analogous to the Simiton legislation, separating out the REC bucket, just focusing on homegrown renewables. Are we an exception?
You're not an exception in the sense that other markets use RECs for purposes of meeting the renewable portfolio standard. I think the California legislation is an exception in how complex and somewhat complicated it is with respect to the different buckets. Other states have carve-outs. As I mentioned, there are offshore wind carve-outs, there are solar carve-outs, but for example, New Jersey implements those with ORECs and SRECs. So again, I think the tendency for the competitive wholesale electricity markets to implement their RPS requirements, the tendency is for them on the East Coast to use a REC concept. The vertically integrated utilities, however, who don't have markets, so outside of the markets in the United States, such as California, those vertically integrated utilities, it's not so much of an issue because they're procuring and they're already on the system. So they're not, the RPS requirement for those states, and there are 29 states that have an RPS requirement, but the RPS requirement for those states with vertically integrated utilities, they don't use RECs because it's not a delivery issue. For the most part, the renewables are being built onto the system already.
Mr. Vargas.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I see that we're coming to the end of our time with you, so I want to thank you for the testimony you gave. It's been great. If that's what we call it here, testimony. I'm not sure.
Yes.
But for our conversation, I'm reading your bio, and I see that you've got a lot of experience in California, particularly with the Path 15 upgrade. So my questions about transmission, I'm trying to figure out reliability, really. Maybe that was a factor of having these resources in state. I wonder how much vulnerability there could be in having these things out and in kind of being at the risk of blackouts or things like that. And since you're also looking at your bio, you have a history in mathematical economics. I'm going to ask you a kind of a nerdy question here. Is there a way to quantify that reliability or that risk or that vulnerability into a value? In other words, can we quantify the value in having those resources, you know, in state and reliable versus out of state?
Yes. The answer is, as a nerdy mathematical economist, you can quantify anything.
Mm-hmm.
So there are ways to do that. They tend to be a lot more engineering load flow. Mm-hmm. The Cal ISO would be perfectly situated to assess the reliability issues. But I want to address something else you said that was implied in your question. If there's a concern about reliability and having so many renewable resources connected to the grid, you actually have greater reliability by having them interspersed across a larger geographical area and even outside of California.
But those all follow the same path. I mean, you're basically putting your eggs in two paths, as I was showing in your chart. Is that
sorry, that was notional. What I didn't show you was an extensive transmission network. So those are just high level paths. There's the electrical transmission system in the United States is considered a man made wonder of the world, just how long it is and how extensive it is, and so the alternating current system that we have, and that's why the Western Interconnect is to the west of the Rocky Mountains. It's a very robust system, and the balancing authorities are responsible for maintaining that robustness. I think where balancing authorities start to have challenges is when they have an extensive amount of renewables either in one location or a very large portion on the grid. There are some places like Ireland and even parts of Texas that have had more than 100% renewable production for given load pockets. It creates a lot of unwieldiness. It's very hard to manage. Again, I'm not the system operator, but there are potential reliability issues and rules that need to be in place to be able to incorporate high levels of renewable integration. There's a dynamic shift that's happening with our electricity industry today. In the past, load was given and generation varied. but with high levels of renewable resources, the generation is given, and potentially the system or the load must vary to be able to meet that. And so what we're talking about now is renewable resources that, for the most part, will produce whenever they produce, and then the system, according to whatever rules are put into place, operates around that to make sure that we don't have a system-wide blackout or reliability issue. So I would say the broader the geographical area where you can place your renewable resources, the more reliable your system is going to be. And I think that allowing for a more diversified, flexible option for procuring renewable resources that includes both imports and in-state renewables, according to the most cost-effective approach, if that's the rule, that's better for the reliability of the system.
Thank you. Any other questions from the commission?
Comment, Mr. Chair.
Just an observation. I want to call it, thank you for your presentation. I will call it testimony. What comes to my mind, all this is well, very well prepared. But going back to page 6 and your comment about, or where we talk about concentrating solar, the first thing comes from where you're going to need water to create steam, to create energy. Those are the same areas where we have water shortages. So I don't know if any of that has taken into consideration. And when we speak about where the wind blows the best is on our coast, and then you have your coastal commission, that's going to be another distraction for you to accomplish some of those goals. So any of your thoughts or any requirements or any of these figures take into consideration CEQA EIRs that might stop you from moving forward? Any request that has come forward to say to, for us to accomplish those goals, we need some waivers from either CEQA or whatever follows CEQA.
Right.
California Environmental Quality Act.
Right. So
we all want this, but how to get there is going to be as easy as said here.
Right. So my expertise is more focused on the economics and operations of the electrical system. And of course, in order to understand that, we have to understand how the environmental regulations are being put into place. To a lesser extent, I'm not as familiar with the siting requirements and the environmental requirements and the other hindrances that would prevent some of the projects from being put into place. But if you were to open the renewable resources that could meet the renewable portfolio standard to a broader selection, then the more cost-effective, doable, highly probable resource projects would be able to receive power purchase agreements and move forward with being built. So there are roadblocks. That's why 50% of projects with approved power purchase agreements don't go into production. Yes. Yes. Well, you know, again, if you have a power purchase agreement and you're a developer of these renewable projects, it's a lot easier to get the financing, but it doesn't mean that you can take it to the bank. It doesn't mean your project gets built, because there are a lot of other constraints that could come into play. I mean, endangered species, for example.
So I wanted to recognize Commissioner Shapiro for a final question, and then we'll move to the next question.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed this very much. And I wanted to quote something and ask if you could maybe give it some context in light of your report. I'm going to quote here. High energy prices create a tension for politicians between protecting consumers and allowing them to protect themselves. With power so expensive, it should be clear that neither regulated utilities nor states can afford to provide the risk management services that consumers desire. You're familiar with that author. How does what you've told us today figure into that quote?
Okay, so that quote has two sides of the equation. One is the higher prices associated with implicitly meeting regulatory and policy objectives. And then the other is the ratepayers having flexibility to be able to manage their risk and to be able to minimize their costs. There's, in a sense, a wholesale market side to that equation, or the generation side, which translates into the costs and the retail side of the equation. I think there are a lot of regulations that have been put into place in California, and they have costs associated with them. But California also has the opportunity, given the smart meters that have been installed and the competitive retail market that was implemented, to allow for consumers to better manage their usage and to shift their load if required, to optimize given the constraints that they'd be facing or the cost they'd have to pay. In order to do that, they need to be sent the right price signal, and I think the retail side of the equation needs to be taken into account. I think a lot of the regulations are focused on the generation side or the wholesale side, but if you're going to stick the cost to the consumers, I think it's only fair to give the consumers the opportunity to be able to respond appropriately to price signals to be able to reduce their electricity consumption, increase their energy efficiency, and shift their load to be able to respond to higher prices.
Takes me back to a question I wanted to clarify. In your earlier equation where you were solving for where load was one of the parts of one of the solution, is load, in considering the RPS need, is load net of demand management, energy efficiency efforts, or is it a gross load?
So within the last couple of years, the independent system operators have added something new to their load projections. Many of the independent system operators include both load as projected and load with energy efficiency programs in place. And so in this case, what we took into account, if it was available, would be the energy efficiency projection of the load. And I would have to go back to see, based on the numbers that we used, whether that is incorporated or not. But generally, when we are provided with both of those load projections, we take, if we don't look at both, we'll take the energy efficiency piece.
Commissioner Schwartz.
So maybe this is a good segue to when we eventually hear from Mr. Como, the ratepayer advocate. But I don't want to lose sight of the comment that Ms. Bodell made just before she answered Commissioner Gay's question, and that is, what tools do the consumers have? I mean, all of this planning strikes me as, whatever projection one uses, into an increase in rates. So the question is, if you know these rates, who, and they don't have any tools to deal with it. So who within the state of California can move policy levers, whether it's tiered pricing, whether it's demand management tools, whether it's giving the consumer choices in terms of credits to increase energy efficiency in their home, smart meters or smart thermostats. I mean, who's pulling the lever to help the consumer deal with the inevitable cost increase? And who should, if no one is?
So, as an economist who spent time in the late 1990s designing competitive retail markets, I would argue that market forces should be used and that the full set of options should be given to customers in a way that rationalizes what they do with an appropriate price signal. One of the approaches that you didn't mention, which is interesting, I grew up in Southern California, and when I went home to visit my mother, went to the house of my friend and her parents, and he had put up solar panels. And they sat there and they showed me the solar panels, and we walked around the house, and he has basically reduced his electricity consumption because of the solar panels across a given year by 90%. And he wanted to go beyond that, but the incentives don't allow to go beyond that. So there are existing mechanisms in place with respect to some of the other policies, and I think those should be considered when rationalizing what the objectives are of the state in environmental policy. And the smart meters are a very important tool that can be properly used, if properly used. The problem is there are a lot of expensive smart meters and you still have dumb prices. And so if you're not sending the right price signal to customers so that they can respond, they really aren't given control as they should be.
Yes. Mr. Burr?
Can't find my button. You spoke about how the retail consumer can install solar panels. How do you address the issue with businesses that are high energy users, and solar panels doesn't begin to address their problems? Solar panels would not begin to serve their needs. We already are in a stressed economy in this state, and with increased electrical, we're going to drive more businesses out of the state.
Correct. Now, the larger commercial industrial users tend to have time of use pricing, and so they may already be receiving the price signal. But now it doesn't matter how good your price signal is, a lot of these costs that we're contemplating with renewables and with other environmental policy is actually just going to be a pass-through and not shown through a price signal. It's just going to be added on top of everything and inescapable in some sense. So with respect to the businesses, there are options that they're already using, and some of them have already installed solar panels where it made economic sense. But the solar panels, again, that's a subsidized program. They don't make sense on a standalone basis at this point, unless there's a government subsidy that's helping make them more cost effective.
I recently had a conversation with a man who has a manufacturing company, and they have machines that suck up energy. And he has a 65,000 square foot building, and he said if he covered his roof with solar panels, it would generate enough electricity to run one machine for 8 hours. He has 60 machines that he runs sometimes 24 hours.
Yes. Well, and most certainly there are a lot of customers who either can't respond to proper price signal or incentives, or in some cases don't want to respond. They're just it's not worth it to them. But I think of more concern are those who can't respond. The reality is they can respond. They can leave the state. They can close down the factory, right? So I think none of us want that to happen. But that is one of the possibilities if prices are too high, which is the state's no longer competitive.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. If you just kind of stay available to us from time to time for conversations, that'd be appreciated. Oh, yeah, Mr. Whalen.
I'll be quick, and I apologize. I had an emergency I had to take. So just a quick comment following on this last comment. I think at some point it would be really good to know, and you've done some of this, not just the comparative cost for generation, but the effects in other states, and to try to get a handle on movement of productive capacity out of the state, because I think that, and to have a sense, and you may have covered some of this, of the cost that you've talked about from bringing this production in from other states, to get a handle on how that relates to the overall cost for energy. And I just make one final note. We had the example of the individual with the machines. I do know that one of the reasons that Intel is making in Chandler, Arizona, I think it's the largest chip factory in the world, and they're also putting billions in New Mexico and Oregon, is energy cost. So that's not directly related, but anyway, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you again.
Thank you very much.
We could call the next witness, please, Stuart.
Our next witness is Carl Zakella, who will discuss the best energy in the West. Mr. Zakella is the director of Western Transmission for the Natural Resources Defense Council. Previously, he spent more than 20 years in leadership positions with the Sierra Club. Mr. Zakella is director of the Climate Action Reserve, founding steering committee member for the California Apollo Alliance, a director of the Center for Energy Efficiency and Renewable Technologies, an environmental representative on the Renewable Energy Transmission Initiative, or REDI, among other posts. Good morning, Mr. Zakella. Thanks for coming.
Welcome to the Cooler Commission, and please proceed.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. NRDC is grateful to be invited. We're a national nonprofit organization of scientists, lawyers, environmental specialists, dedicated to protecting public health and the environment. We were founded in 1970, and we serve more than 1 million members, supporters, and environmental activists, 250,000 of whom live here in California. We have offices in New York, Washington, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Chicago, and Beijing, and energy policy has been a particular specialty for our organization for many years. We believe the goal of increased reliance on renewables and protection of our nation's unique and sensitive places are not necessarily in conflict. It's one reason why we've become so involved with renewable energy and transmission siting issues, not only here in California, but across the western United States. And here in California, we are blessed with an extraordinary richness of renewable energy resources. You saw the maps that were presented in the previous testimony. I do think that it's just an embarrassment of riches, really, that we have here. Our ability to make a transformation to a clean energy economy is quite clear. It is possible. It is happening, in fact, and it is coming at a lower and lower cost. The reduced cost of renewables has been apparent in the bids that have been proffered for renewable portfolio standard offers for power purchase agreements, for example, where, as Commissioner Florio testified at his confirmation hearing a few weeks ago, we're starting to see bids come in at the market price referent. In other words, competitive with natural gas now. So I think the ability to make this transformation is clear. We have some obstacles that we need to address here in the state. They're not unique to California, as you'll hear in a minute, but I do think that they will require some significant changes if we're to get this done at the lowest cost, the highest level of efficiency, and the lowest environmental impact.
So let me just stop.
Sure,
because
please.
I've heard this before, the point that you made about we're reaching market parity between natural gas and renewables. That's inconsistent with when you look at the overall costs, including the upfront capital investment in transmission lines and siting and generation for solar. How do you square that? I mean, because that was a critical part of the last witness's testimony.
Sure. Well, I have to say that capital costs are high for large-scale renewable projects. They're high for other projects as well. Once they're built, the fuel is free. And power purchase agreements are contracts over time for delivered power at a certain rate. And they are being bid in at these rates. We had an initial wave of contracts that were quite high to comply with the renewable portfolio standard. Many of those fell by the wayside. Many of those projects did not come into fruition. What we're seeing now is we're starting to get our feet under ourselves. We really blazed a trail here in California on this stuff. There are 27 other states that have renewable portfolio standards. A lot of them came following us. Many of, in fact, most of, if not all of our renewable energy policies are intended to help this state deal with climate change impacts that we're experiencing now and are projected over time. They're intended to lead other parts of the country. We understood that there would be an initial cost for this, but we also understood by creating economies of scale and developing industries, those costs would decline. And in fact, that's what's happening. So we're starting to see now, we're at the beginning of this, we've seen this historic downward trend that was mentioned in the previous testimony for photovoltaics. We're seeing wind prices coming down. We're seeing the technology improve. We're seeing the integration issues being reduced, and therefore the cost of integrating the resources being reduced. And we're learning a lot more about how to optimize the system to integrate more renewables at lower costs and greater reliability. A lot is happening in a very short period of time here. They're game changers. Just like natural gas fracking has reduced the price of natural gas dramatically, the declines in photovoltaic costs have been really earth-shaking, frankly, in this business.
If I could follow on, because I think this is a key question, and it would be great if, not today, if at some point I think the commission could see this. I want to make sure I understand this. You're saying that there are actual viable companies bidding and saying, under some contract arrangement over a period of time or whatever, that they will supply energy at a price, and I assume of increasing quantities, that is the same or very close to the cost of natural gas.
Yes, it's starting to happen now. We are seeing PPAs come into the state that are at the market price referent. It's happened for more than a year now. So we're starting to see this trend occur. We've had this massive fall off in solar pricing, for example, that has helped make this happen. but I also think that we have a longer-term trend of declining prices that can help us even do better.
That would be wonderful. I'd like, when you say if power companies, and I think we're going to later hear from a former CEO of Southern California Edison, maybe he can enlighten us on this, but if we're actually seeing, Southern California Edison, PG&E, SDG&E get contracts like that, I think we really need that would be earth shaking, because that is a game changer. So I'd like to see that.
I'd only point out that the data we got in the last testimony, the cost of the solar PV that she estimated, all in, including fuel at the sun fuel at zero and the operation and maintenance costs, was 3.5 times the comparable gas turbine plant.
So exactly.
It's a long, which in this data, there's a long way to go between.
Well,
what Mr. Stella said,
that's why I think I'd like to see the contracts, because this data, is what basically everyone, even and those supporting the RPS, have accepted over time, hoping for what you're saying. But if it's happening now, I'd sure it'd be.
But keep in mind
that's the question.
That has a 2009 figure.
It does, for sure. But still,
this is a trend that we're seeing. To be clear, do you see those? We're starting to see this happen. We're seeing bids coming in.
You've got copies of contracts?
Do I have copies of contracts? I don't have them with me.
But I mean, they're there for us to get.
Public Utilities Commission has accepted.
PUC's got them.
Yeah, this information is publicly available.
Let's get them.
The contracts were private.
I think that the information is available. Certainly, Commissioner Florio referred to it as confirmation hearing. This isn't a secret. If you're really interested, let's get the information in.
That's Earth. That's the question.
These are trends that we're beginning to see occur here.
But the apples to apples comparison is on price per megawatt delivered. Is that what we're talking about, per hour?
Yeah, I'd say that's right.
Okay. Well, that's important because but that doesn't take into account the sunk costs associated with the capital expenditures, building the facilities and transmitting the power.
But the witness is saying is their proposals to, let's just take Southern California Edison. There's a proposal that says we will supply you the power. Mm-hmm. Forget the capital costs. This is what we'll supply it to you for, and it's competitive with what natural gas costs.
We are starting to see some contracts come in at the market price reference.
Wait,
that's what I said.
The PPA may describe may call out what the cost to the power company would be for obtaining the power. But that doesn't necessarily mean that there isn't going to be a hike in rates, because the rate hike would be justified to accommodate the cost associated with the capital expenditures.
They're not rate basing the cost of these plants. These plants are built and operated independently. The power is purchased by the utility. Utilities are not paying.
PPA includes the capital.
Yeah, they have making a bid to say this is what we'll do it for, including everything. Mm-hmm. So it is included.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
It doesn't include transmission, but it does include the cost of plant.
Right. Well, there are some expenses to that that are probably incorporated into those rates too.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's a trend we're starting to see. We're seeing a really big shift here is the point.
Without subsidy, they're providing that.
Well, I think we still have subsidies in place at this moment. I mean, the solar investment tax credit doesn't expire till 2016, for example. The wind production tax credit is expiring.
Well, if we can get to a point where it truly is competitive, I've never heard that before, but if we can get to, the reasons have always been the other reasons you've cited, but if we can get to that point, that would be remarkable.
There are big technological leaps being made right now in wind technologies, in the efficiency of the turbines, in the way they operate, making them easier to integrate into the grid, things that are actually going to be lowering costs and are lowering costs. I mean, but it's starting to happen. It's going to be a while before we take full advantage of the shift of this. I'm pointing out the trend is is noticeable, and it's quite remarkable that we're seeing, because of the reasons that were mentioned about capital costs, that we're seeing PPAs come in at this level. Let's take note of that. It's a success.
Okay, keep going.
Okay, great.
We often get sidetracked, so.
That's okay.
Or maybe not. On track.
Well, we have, as I mentioned, a really great richness of renewable energy resources. In fact, it was estimated during the Renewable Energy Transmission Initiative that we had about 500,000 megawatts of nameplate capacity of renewable energy resources in California. So that is a very large amount of renewable energy resources that we have available to us. However, we are not an island. And if our goals are to deal with our climate challenges, we're not going to deal with climate change by ourselves. We have to get coal-fired power plants in other parts of the West out of service. Part of doing that takes advantage of the renewable energy resources elsewhere in the West. And our ability to optimize how our grid works, to reduce the integration costs and the generation costs of renewables that we utilize, will depend on us participating in a broader energy market across the West. And I do think that while our RPS law does limit imports, I do think that that first bucket can be met with a significant number of external resources. Some of the transmission solutions that are being proposed by major wind developers in the Intermountain West, for example, have destinations ending points in the ISO service territory, at the El Dorado substation, for example. There are two major wind projects that are seeking to interconnect with DC lines to the El Dorado substation. The DC lines are delivery lines from point A to point B. They're not AC lines that can have on-ramps and off-ramps everywhere. They actually would comply with Bucket 1. So if the Transwest Express transmission line, for example, were to be completed, that line would interconnect the wind farm in Wyoming to consumers in Los Angeles and would comply with Bucket 1. Just to point that out. A few of the things that I think we need to do, that NRDC believes we need to do to take advantage of the state's ability to develop these resources, in addition to providing for adequate transmission infrastructure, establish a centralized authority for transmission planning and operations to ensure coordinated planning, permitted siting, and system control, require operational coordination and balancing between all five of California's balancing area authorities, facilitate stakeholder participation into a single statewide transmission planning process, and integrate California into broader regional planning, as I mentioned a moment ago. Greater coordination of transmission planning and approval bodies via transmission authority needs to incorporate the operations and planning efforts of the CPUC and the ISO, as well as the public utilities, including the Los Angeles Department of Water and Power. We do have five different balancing authorities in the state. They're not well coordinated. There is increasing coordination between and among them to a certain extent, but we have a lot of duplication in our transmission infrastructure. It makes it more expensive to have duplication in that system. We have less reliability as a result of that because we can't balance appropriately between those authorities. There are limited connections, for example, between LADWP and CAISO. That inhibits both reliability and cost and makes renewable integration more expensive, frankly. So as we have 38 balancing area authorities across the entire Western Electricity Coordinating Council system, there are five just here in California, too. Getting our own system in order and being able to interact better with the rest of the West and have the rest of the West reform in order to react better with California are two major improvements I think we need to really focus on. A stakeholder participation part of this has been important because in order to get transmission approved, as everyone should know, it's a very difficult job in California but elsewhere as well. And in order to do that, we've had a great deal of success in trying to bring people to the table early to discuss what transmission is needed, try to understand where the renewable energy resources will be located, and to come up with solutions that can help address those. That was done in the Renewable Energy Transmission Initiative, where we came up with an essential zoning system for California to identify places with the fewest environmental conflicts that could be identified for renewable energy resources, and find a way to interconnect those resources with transmission that made the most use of our existing transmission system. New rights of way are the hardest part of getting transmission established. Where we have the ability to increase the capacity of our existing rights of ways, that's often the most cost-effective, least controversial way to go about it, and the least impact on California's remarkable natural resources. And you know, if we can do this, we can actually really increase the amount of energy we not only interconnect here in state, but also improve our ability to import resources, because a lot of the same corridors that are going to be used to bring power from, say, Arizona, New Mexico, Nevada, are going to come through substations like El Dorado that will rely very heavily on transmission that's currently operated either by LADWP or Southern California Edison, for example. I think there's a lot of value that's been provided by the stakeholder process to date, and we are seeing that the fruits of that. Transmission is always going to be somewhat controversial, but we are seeing very little in terms of actual litigation over transmission has been proposed in California, the Sunrise Power Link having been a major exception. But I would say that from my perspective, just about everything that could be done wrong in developing transmission was initially done wrong there. I think that San Diego Gas and Electric has proceeded in a much better way since they took their lumps over the initial controversy over the Sunrise Power Link, and that line is being built, by the way. But the rest in California that we've seen, we've even seen environmental groups and conservation groups that are interested in the desert support transmission, so to the Western River to Devers, for example, as a result of the renewable energy zoning and the use of existing rights of ways that we've seen in California. So having the centralized stakeholder participation process to transmission planning, we centralize the function of transmission planning. Having one place where people interact is important. Right now, if people want to get involved, if you're an environmental stakeholder, if you're a transmission line sponsor, if you're an independent power producer, you've got to go to the California Transmission Planning Group, the California Public Utilities Commission, the California Energy Commission, and the California Independent System Operator, and participate in four different venues to determine an outcome that's relevant for a transmission project or to interconnect a certain suite of renewable energy projects. And partly that's because we've been stuck in this paradigm for the last several years of sequential approvals of transmission using an interconnection queue. CAISO has really been trying to reform that process and give them a lot of credit for that. But I think we need to look broader than just who's in line for transmission, because as was noted before, the success rate of projects is not a sterling. Not every project is going to get built. There are 70,000 megawatts in the California interconnection queue right now. We know that 70,000 nameplate megawatts of power isn't going to come out of that queue, and real projects are getting stuck in how we analyze and plan transmission. We need to look, I think, also at system benefits when we're making determinations about what we produce in terms of transmission plans. There are opportunities to open up new areas of renewable energy. And just as was mentioned earlier in the previous testimony about geographic diversity, reducing the variability of renewable energy resources, the problems with integrating them, we can do better in the state as well. There are areas of the Central Valley that are our prime areas for photovoltaic energy, for example, that are waiting for transmission, that if we were to build that transmission, we would improve reliability overall in the state. We would provide better access to regulation resources like the Helms Pump Storage Facility, which can help us integrate variable renewables energy resources when we have clouds pass overhead and whatnot, which we're underutilizing right now. So transmission has multiple benefits other than just interconnecting people got in line, and I don't mean to disparage anybody who's got a project that got in line, but we have to make some judgments here about what's better for the overall operation of the grid in the state. And not operate the state's grid like it's five different chunks, separate chunks, because that is costly, it's environmentally damaging, and it's actually very wasteful to do. How would we do that? I think if we were to, my recommendation, NRDC's recommendation, is to consider establishing a centralized transmission planning authority that would coordinate the activities of the various players, come out with a single state plan that takes into consideration optimization of the state grid, and identifies high-priority transmission upgrades that are related to accomplishing better system reliability.
And sorry for speaking out of turn, Mr. Chairman. Who should be doing that right now? Should that be under somebody's guise right now, or is that an existing organization that you propose putting that under, or is that?
I think it would have to be a new entity. Right now, what we have is an effort on the part of the various agencies to coordinate between and among themselves. I believe you need a driver for a process like this. You need to have an entity that can pull people together and require coordination, require a big look at the system and say, why are we building two parallel lines to serve the same markets from Imperial County to Southern California consumers when we can build one line, have half the environmental impact and half the cost by means of an actual example? So I do think there's a way to do this. It breaks a lot of taboos to do it. There's what some people refer to as religious differences between the publicly owned and the investor-owned utilities. Some of it is based in legitimate concerns about trying to maintain reliability of their systems, but I think it's built on a paradigm that's really out of date. And what we're seeing in a lot of the rest of the country, where we have more coordinated markets, where we have more coordinated operations, the ability to integrate resources more cheaply, to identify the reserves that are needed, so you don't build reserves that you don't need. We have a great opportunity to do self-regulation, self-balancing with our renewables here in California, renewables to renewables, but also taking advantage of our gas fleet. We're lucky to have a predominantly natural gas generation fleet that's operating at about an average 30% capacity factor. We have a lot of capacity to utilize here if we look at the system in its entirety and utilize it in a way that benefits California ratepayers and consumers better. Be very high environmental payoff, far lower our carbon emissions, and also helps us provide additional leadership as the rest of the West tries to figure out how to build a more integrated system, which is a constant and ongoing conversation that's occurring now, not just between the balancing area authorities and the Western Electricity Coordinating Council, but the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, which has promulgated a new rule that would require coordinated regional and inter-regional planning for transmission. The first compliance deadline is in October. CAISO will be the compliance entity for California. But this is something that helps set us up to have a better, more efficient system that takes better advantage of the resources from around the West, as the previous witness said.
Commissioner Quinn had a question.
I guess this is a follow-up, actually, because I was going to ask that question, but then you raised something to me. Why would the Energy Commission not be a logical place to give this authority? What's wrong with that?
I think what we're seeing here is trying to pull something together that doesn't play into the rivalries that already exist about these issues. That's part of the problem that we've had, is the Public Utilities Commission has a certain set of authorities. The Energy Commission has the authority to establish corridors, for example. There have been previous efforts to consolidate things under the Energy Commission. I think that this body has recommended that, actually. It proved to not be tenable. What I think might be more tenable is looking at a way to gather them together, organize them under one process, and recognize the rate-setting authorities should remain with the Public Utilities Commission, and the analytical functions that are with the Energy Commission should remain with the Energy Commission, and the licensing functions that they have for power plants. I think that there is a way to maintain those things and not create sort of the schism that we continuously see between these agencies. But they have to be coordinated. They have to have a certain set of requirements that focus on optimizing the system first, and not playing into the continued balkanization of transmission planning in the state.
I guess it seems like to me always creating a new agency is not always the answer. I guess I've been out of touch with this, and this is my first hearing on this topic. So is there such a problem that if you were to give this authority to an existing agency, the others won't cooperate? I mean, what's the issue here?
Well, You know, I don't want to say that they wouldn't cooperate, but I don't think that that model was one that could fly or didn't fly the last time that it was suggested. There is an independent role for these agencies that I think needs to be respected within the purview of what they're doing. And what I'm suggesting is not merging all of their functions. What I'm suggesting is that we coordinate around transmission planning. And that's, I think, a bit different than saying we create a super agency between and among them.
Yeah, Jonathan?
So I can understand your recommendations. In a sense, aren't you suggesting in your solutions 1 and 3 either the creation of a super controlling commission or agency and or somebody in the governor's office who is taking a greater leadership role and trying to encourage that?
Well, yes, I think that I'm saying both actually are important here. We have seen a great deal of coordination occur because there has been a strong person in the governor's office. Been a real benefit to the Desert Renewable Energy Conservation Plan, a real benefit to both governors, previous present and previous governor. And without having someone that can hold the agencies accountable and require their coordination, it actually doesn't happen.
So with that in mind, and in light of, I think, our general, well, I'll speak for myself, aversion to creating yet another bureaucratic entity, if you had a strong person in the governor's office, would it also be valuable to have a strong person in the attorney general's office? That is, aren't so many of these issues having to do with trying to negotiate around the regulations and laws that we have right now and the potential for lawsuits down the road?
I don't see quite the same need, to be honest with you. This is more about trying to marshal resources, avoid duplication in environmental review. I'm not a big fan of creating off-ramps from CEQA necessarily. I think a lot of the issues can be dealt with through siting and planning. Where you put things and how you interconnect them, understanding that and doing it well reduces the environmental impacts for one thing, and also I think reduces a lot of the controversy around these projects. That's why this is an important tool that we have, and it is very unwieldy to try to get to the finish line with the transmission recommendations that are overarching right now, because you don't have anybody looking at the system as a whole.
Any other questions?
Commissioner Weiland and Commissioner Schwartz.
Oh, go ahead.
Commissioner Schwartz and Senator Weiland.
In the not too distant past, the AQMD refused to give the appropriate licenses to, I think, one or two peaker plants, one of which was in Hayward. So there are limits to the idea of coordination or having some sort of strong voice in the governor's office. Ultimately, in that instance, the AQMD concluded they weren't going to give the permits, and it took a special legislation to override it. That strikes me as an odd way to go about dealing with what that utility thought was a pretty critical need, and apparently the legislature agreed. I don't know a way that coordination can solve that problem. I mean, at the end of the day, you have good people who sit on important regulatory agencies who are going to follow their mandates.
Yeah.
But there has to be some other way other than running up to Sacramento to get some special bill passed to deal with it.
I completely agree with you. I think protecting human health from air quality issues is, you know, especially important here in our state where we have such large impacts relative to anywhere else. I do think by planning more smartly, more intelligently, what we can do is wind up needing fewer fossil reserves that lead to situations like that. I think you're always going to have incongruous situations come up that you don't expect, that sometimes you need to have a policy decision made, such as the one you described. But I don't know any way around that. I think that's just part of the price of having responsive government. That's what's going to occur. But I think by planning better and looking at system needs, so you're not building duplicative reserves, you're not building a peaker you don't need, when you can balance the system better, when you can have transmission that gives you access to resources that prevent the need for duplicative reserves. This is a very significant cost, by the way, and it is a very significant source of pollution. In the Southwest Power Pool, a neighboring control area, they have an energy imbalance market that has helped reduce the amount of reserves that are needed across that entire area, geographic area of, I think, six or seven states. And that has saved people money and reduced emissions. I mean, I think that's part of what we're trying to do here is create situations where we're not building things we don't need, that we're getting the most out of the system that we have, that we're integrating these resources in the most cost-effective way that we can, and we're not creating undue burdens upon the people who are building the resources that we need. So I think we can do much better at that and avoid situations like this and having people come to the legislature. There's no guarantee that you won't have those situations, though.
Senator Wyland?
Yeah, just quickly, I think it'd be wonderful for all the reasons that you stated and we've talked about forever and done up here if we could make this work. To me, though, right now, the bottom line is what is the cost to the user compared to other costs? And I'm thinking particularly in a state where we have the second highest unemployment in the country, where privately a very senior official in this government has said that we all know the real rate of unemployment is closer to 17%, where the human cost is really, really, really difficult. We all know what it is nationally, but here. And at the same time, when we have some companies leaving and that be a part of it, I just think at the end of the day, we need to know, can we deliver this in such a way that it doesn't hurt jobs? And the people who can best tell us that, because they're in the business, are those who are in it, because there are hundreds of factors that they know that we don't. So I hope your dream is realizable, and we'll see.
Does your group have a position on demand management pricing?
On demand management pricing?
Yeah.
It's not my area, but I'm sure that there are colleagues that are working directly on that. I can get somebody in touch with you if you'd like.
Okay. And the other question I had is on the intermittency issue relative to renewables, what's your view of, you know, the current technology, which basically requires that we run close to parallel systems to account for the fact that renewables drop on and off the grid so quickly, and we've got to run the existing plants at low yields and then be able to fire them up on minutes notice?
Well, I think that,
because it seems we're not going to get as much reduction in our carbon footprints because we're basically going to have run parallel systems, and we don't have the technologies yet to either store or deal with that situation otherwise.
Well, I think primarily what we're seeing is that variability can be aggregated by geographic diversity of resources, by matching the profiles of resources. Some of this happens already, by the way.
Sure.
Tehachapi Wind comes onto the grid in the evening. It can be stored at Helms, for example, if we're in a better integrated system. We have the solar energy systems with very sharp diurnal curves in the morning and the evening that can blend a little bit. Those curves overlap very significantly. If we had a more integrated import strategy from around the rest of the region, there have been studies done that indicate the great comparability of resources to help smooth out the variability of renewable energy resources and result in, as I mentioned before, fewer reserves being needed to provide stability for the grid. For example, the University of Wyoming has done a study that shows Wyoming wind comparability with Colorado wind, Utah wind, California wind. It's very good news for us if we're able to integrate in a way that takes advantage of the generation profiles. Not only do they have a higher capacity factor, but they operate at times that complement our wind profiles, especially San Gorgonio, for example. We are seeing research that came out of Northrop Grumman that using data that they produced for the Department of Homeland Security that showed the benefits of integrating resources across broader geographies really aggregated variability and reduce the need for reserves and operational shaping and firming.
Doesn't that imply a much greater need for flexibility in the bucket one, bucket two, bucket three approach to that California's taken?
I would prefer more flexibility in those buckets. I do think that they permit a certain amount of imports from out of state that are, as I mentioned earlier, being planned to comply with that bucket. You're seeing people understand what's needed to be done there. And we're also seeing other utilities in other states beginning to align with CAISO, for example. So there's quite a bit happening. We're also selling power from California. We're selling geothermal energy from the Imperial Valley to the Salt River Project right now. A PPA has been agreed to there. So the opportunities, I think, exist to blend the resources that we have, to take advantage of their operating profiles. And importantly for us, and we have a great advantage in having this very flexible, underutilized gas fleet, that we can actually use this more flexibility. We can repurpose natural gas for flexibility resources and have the renewable energy resources provide what is considered much of the main consumption today. And we can easily do this. We have such a wealth of renewable energy resources. I shouldn't say easily. We can certainly do this.
We'd say CAISO doesn't think it's easy, so.
I think CAISO does understand, though, that we already have an energy imbalance market in California. The rest of the West does not. But CAISO understands and has done integration studies itself that show that importing large amounts of wind from the rest of the West would not challenge our system very significantly, partly because of the diversity of the resources. States that have had problems, such as Washington State and Oregon, where much of the wind is concentrated at one flow port in BPA's system on the Columbia River, that's a problem, but we can help with that problem, too. We have valuable resources that can provide balancing services to other states that we're interconnected with, and that's part of what I think we're after here. I don't think the variability is as big an issue as is portrayed to be. It certainly doesn't have to be. The interconnection studies done by NREL have shown that we can interconnect large amounts of renewables with relatively little issue. And I think people need to remember that because of other clean air standards, we're seeing a lot of coal plants begin to come off of the grid. This is going to free up transfer capacity in other states to help us get a better grid utilization and get maybe more access to some of those resources without some new transmission lines in certain places, too. People analyzing exactly what's going to be done when. Studies being done at the Western Electricity Coordinating Council right now to explore these issues as part of the transmission planning process that they have.
Okay. Commissioner Kay? Then Commissioner Brewer.
Thank you. What's your organization's position on renewable energy credits? We heard earlier that their use to meet the renewable portfolio standard is pretty constrained in California, although, I mean, I haven't dug deeply into it enough to understand why, but I was curious as to whether you think that's something that could be a tool that could be expanded in order to encourage more investment in renewable facilities or not?
Well, I think we've been supportive of some limits on RECs. And one of our concerns is that if you're simply buying a credit and you're disassociating it from the energy, there's no guarantee that that energy is actually being used to offset power somewhere else. It could be dumped. It could be energy that isn't utilized to offset coal-fired emissions, for example. So I think there's a real concern that we want to see power plants that are actually built and operated that serve a function in helping us meet our carbon reduction goals.
Is placing a ceiling on their use in California, does that specifically meet that goal?
I think it does meet that goal to a certain extent. I think that whether or not that ceiling is the correct ceiling, we can have a conversation about. I have not been directly involved with negotiations on that, and we did support the final bill. So, I think I better not take it any further than there.
I appreciate that. Commissioner Brewer, and then I think we'll excuse you and go to our next witness.
You commented that thermal energy is being sold in the Central Valley to out of state. Did I understand that correctly?
Oh, you mean geothermal energy?
Geothermal.
Yes, from the Imperial Valley. There's a very first power purchase agreement's been signed between a generator from the Imperial Valley to the Salt River Project in Arizona.
All right.
So,
And why, I'm not understanding, why is that not being utilized here in this state instead of sold off? Is it in the wrong bucket?
It's not necessarily that. There is a demand for that resource in Arizona. The National Renewable Energy Laboratory did a study last year to show, to explore where we might see commercial interchanges between various states, wind power coming from the northwest to California, solar energy from Arizona to California. But one of the things that their research identified was there was a market in Arizona for California geothermal energy. And I think a better integrated market